Good evening, everyone. We are on a monthly, weekly lecture that we have here, followed by the Hebrew Path to the Just. The Path to the Just series is already on CDs. 21 lectures on one MP3 CD. About, 35 hours of Torah in one CD. So I can take advantage on it.
Did you bring any with you?
I have in a car. If you wait until midnight, you can have. If not, everyone can order it from the CD, from the website. We give it for cost-wise $1 each. Take advantage. Give it to friends. Actually, I just before I entered here.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Before I entered here, I met a Jew.
I want to give this to a lot of people. So, yeah.
I met a Jew. Never put in his life tefillin. I have to estimate that he was 40 years old. He met a Persian kid, not a kid, a man already, spoke to him about tefillin, convinced him to buy tefillin. I brought him tefillin. I met with him now one block away. And when I spoke to him on the phone last week about tefillin, I already gave him the website to watch Torah and Science. So he's already a very serious person. That's why I always say there's thousands of Jews like this, ignorant, naive, but heart of gold. All you need is 1 hour to talk to them or to give them one lecture to hear. That's it. They're in. Nothing else you have to do. We gotta get these people at least. There's many arrogant ones that everything make an argument. If they see Hashem, they still argue. There's a lot of work with them. We also have to save them, but it's a lot more work. But at least I say, who knows, maybe there's a million Jews like this in the world. All they have to do is just to get to them for this 1 hour to give them a CD, and that's it. And they're in. And this guy is definitely in. I gave him now 7 CDs. Well, I told him the right order, how to listen. You should see how he was making comments. Very serious person. The good American Jews that you meet sometimes, you know, they're straight. All they needed is to show them the right direction. So now this Path to the Just, Bezrat Hashem, I saw so many comments about it over the months that we did it. It's all combined into one CD. The Gemara says that in the time of Avraham Avinu, he was converting the Goyim. The Gentiles, in his time, they all worship idols. And all of a sudden, comes a person, Avraham Avinu. He recognized that something has to be here. He didn't know Hashem yet. He knew there's a God. There has to be a God, a creator. But he didn't know Hashem like Moshe Rabbeinu spoke to him. And he knew he went up to Shamayim. Moshe had an idea who is Hashem. But Avraham Avinu, he had to do it on his own. There's no background. His father was worshipping idols, selling idols, coming from an idol home. And searching for the truth and having difficult tests and passed one after the other. And in the end, Hashem called him Avraham Ivri. Ivri means one-sided, that is in one side of the world and everyone else is in the other side. This is a real achievement. We're not talking here. Moshe Rabbeinu, yeah, it's true, he grew up in the palace of Paro. But once he ran away from there, when he was around 30, he ran away. He ran to Kush. Was there for many years, then he went to Midian, and then when he was 80, he came back to Mitzrayim. But his father was Amram. Amram was the most righteous person ever lived, one of the most 4 righteous people in history. That the Gemara said they never made one sin in their entire life. If it's not the sin of Adam and Eve with the snake, he will never die. Just because Adam ate from the tree, and Hashem said that people have to die, that's why he died. Otherwise, he did not have one sin to deserve to die. That's how good his father was, Amram. His mother, Yocheved, his sister Miriam is a prophet, his brother Aaron is a holy man, comes from a very good family. No, so you understand why he became who he became. Even though he was stuttering, he had his issues, but still, he knew Hashem, because Hashem spoke to him, was the greatest prophet. But Avraham Avinu came from where? So since he's a baby, he started to realize what's happening in this world. He's surrounded with idols. He sees all this going by from his father idols. Everyone who is Avodah Zarah. And from the garbage of all garbage, he came and became Avraham Avinu. Abraham, Ibrahim. So he was converting the men, and Sarah was converting the women. So you see, if it's a better way, if a man can convert the men, and women can convert the women, it's better than a man does both. It's better, you can see right away. But in today's generation, it's very difficult to make a lecture only for men or a lecture only for women, separate, it's very difficult. So, you know, Be'ezrat Hashem, we try to do as much as we can. But Avraham Avinu didn't have so much blessing in his work. That's what most people don't know. Everyone knows Avraham, Et HaNefesh Asher Asu B'Charan, all the people he converted, and the Nefesh means soul, that the soul that he created, so it's all his, like his children. But the Midrash said that all these converts that Avraham Avinu converted, they all became bad again after he went away. Once he went away, and they all chazru lesuram, the Midrash say. Why? Even Avraham Avinu, such a holy man that made these people religious and recognize Hashem and knows who there's a one God and to leave their idols, if they didn't have follow-up, they went right back to square one. That's what we see today. Today you make a person religious, but he's not going into a system, into a learning program that every day he's going to learn, or he has a synagogue that he comes in the morning and after he sits for an hour and learn, and he has a local rabbi, and he has on Shabbat, you know, like community that he can meet the community of, you know, and sit with them and talk Divrei Torah and be connected. Right away, within a month or two, all the Torah he built up, it's leaking out. That's the way the world is. A person must have follow-up. I know there's some people who donate a lot of money. They donate a lot of money, but they have one condition. They donate to Kirov organization to make Jews religious in one condition, that they prove to them that they have a follow-up system. They don't have a follow-up system, they don't want to give a dollar. What's the point of filling up the bucket and then kick it? So they say, you want us to give you money? Show us that you do follow-ups. You write names, you call these people, you send them for places for Shabbat, you give them instructions, someone is learning with them 20, 30 minutes a day on the phone. Show us you do something. You have follow-up. You do follow-up, we'll help you out. You don't do follow-up, you know. So someone like me don't have a budget. How can I do follow-up? Well, I'm going to start hiring 20 people, pay them full salaries, and make them fall. So what do? I send them to communities. Where do you live? Go to this place. Where do you live? Go to this rabbi. Where do you live? Go. Plus, I have a natural follow-up. I have more than 1,000 lectures in my website, which is enough for months. For a person to listen to one lecture a day, that's already until his wedding. He started in Bar Mitzvah. By the time he's going to get married, he still have enough to hear. Plus, we fill it up every day. Every day we put one more. It adds up, Baruch Hashem. And what, I'm the only speaker? You're done with me, there's others. There's plenty of good speakers out there. But I always say, we're not disrespecting anybody else. And this is my advice to you and to everyone who listens to us on the internet. Search for the speakers who shake your heart. Bring some fear to your heart and wake you up and show you how far you are from the truth. Those are the ones you have to listen to. All the other speakers which are mellow and nice and polite, politically correct, afraid to say the truth, don't waste time on them, with all the respect. Could be very holy people, I'm not saying no. A person in this world has short time and a lot of work. If you don't have someone to give you the right smack every day to wake you up, what's the point? You hear an hour of Torah, fine, very nice. So you learn Torah. An hour later, you go back to your Christine at work. So what happened to the Torah you learned? Well, what happened? Ah, you hear somebody who shook you up. 3-4 days, you're afraid to make sins. Something good came out of the lecture, no? Just to hear a nice hour of Torah, don't get me wrong, it's still a very big mitzvah. So the mitzvah of learning Torah, no matter who you listen to, you have. The problem is, what's going to be after? That's even more important. Okay, 1 hour Torah, but now you want the next 2-3 days to be clean and kosher. With this 1 hour, even 2 minutes you won't be clean after. A minute later you go back. Why? It didn't scare you. It didn't wake you up. It didn't show you how stingy you are. It didn't show you how far you are from Hashem. It didn't show you what kind of liar you are. It didn't show you what a faker you are. You did not recognize the situation. Still think, I'm minimum Eliyahu Navi or Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai. I didn't make up my mind yet if I'm this or that. That's what most Jews think. Yeah, Jews who eat pork on Yom Kippur, they still think they're righteous, some of them. You know? Where does it say it's not allowed? Right?
You say like
the rabbi in a church, you know, he says it's allowed. Yeah, he played the piano on Yom Kippur. Men and women sing Hallelujah. You know? The rabbi and priests, they come to make a wedding to Yosef and Christine. It happens in America every hour, unfortunately. Everywhere you go. Go to Philadelphia, see what's happened there. Go to other areas. Sometimes I have goyim that they get very inspired, non-Jews, they get inspired by the lecture, and they search in the entire area, the entire state, for one normal Orthodox shul. There's not even one in the entire state. So they only find Reform and Conservative. And those goyim, after 1 week of being there, they say, this place is not pure for me. I feel the impurity over there. They come from a church to a Reform synagogue, and they say it's downgrade for me. And you know what? They're right. You know why? Why it's a real downgrade? See, after all, it's a synagogue, no? You have a Star David over there. What's better? It's downgrade because the Christians, most of them are wrong. Not intentionally. They're wrong. They grew up into this religion. It's full of nonsense. It's not the word of God, but they think that it's the word of God, and they really want to search for this God and follow His truth. And since they're little kids, they told them the New Testament is the truth of God. So they are like naively they follow this. But not intentionally they rebel against God and modify His book. They don't have the nerve to do that, those Christians. Neither the Muslims or many other cults. But those Jews who come and claim we are religious and take the Torah and turn it into a toilet paper, do you find a bigger sinner than them? Of course it's a downgrade. Better for Jews to sit in a church and eat pork on Yom Kippur than to visit 1 minute in these synagogues, Reform and Conservative. Taking the Torah, opening up in the middle of the street and walking over the Torah. You want to join this kind of people? Marry men with men against the laws of God. Marry Jews with non-Jews against the laws of God. Allowing everything, drive on Shabbat, play the piano on Shabbat, do whatever you want, and then call yourself religious? That's what's happening here. So the follow-up is very, very important. We must do the follow-up. And even if you give a CD to your friend, the CD will inspire him. First of all, you have to follow up the next day to see if he listened to the CD. Not just giving it, oh, I did what I have to do. If it was your brother, you call the next day to see. Oh, did you hear? No, not yet. Why? It's great. Trust me. Try 1 hour. You do everything you can, like a salesman. You know the salespeople, how they call you every day? And following up, he has a note. He writes, customer, potential customer, all day notes. Well, it comes to make a few $100 here and there. People are very organized. You want to make eternity of profit, and you just hand it and leave. What is this? It's not the right thing. So what do? You have to follow up. You call the next day. He didn't listen. You wait 2-3 more days. You call again. And you call and you make it your mission. And then you save one soul in 7 years. It was already worth it. 2, it's even better. 5, it's even better. And that's the rule. That's the way it is. When Yitzchak Avinu was born, Avraham Avinu made a meal for everyone, made a party. The question is, when he made a circumcision 8 days later, he did not make a meal. What's more important, the night that the baby is born to make a meal, or when you finally circumcise him and turn him into a Jew? What's more important event? It's very good that he was born, but when you do it for the Brit Milah, it's include the birth, and it's include the circumcision. Even birthdays, It's not a positive custom. Jews should not make birthdays. Why? Because the Torah spoke about birthdays. The Torah said we learned it from Pharaoh, which was a very wicked person. Pharaoh made a party to himself and he celebrated his birthday. Jews should not celebrate their birthday for 2 reasons. Why? It's not a holy custom. It comes from the wicked people. And second is, why are you celebrating losing another year of life? You should cry. Your battery is running out. You shouldn't make a party. A person is 50, now he turns into 51, he makes a party. Moshe, what's the party? My birthday. What birthday? It should be a mourning day. My life is shortened. Apparently, I guess life is so bitter that people are happy already to go towards the end, so they make a party. That's the only explanation. So now the question is, why he didn't make a meal when he did a circumcision to Yitzchak? Because remember, when Avraham Avinu makes circumcision for himself, was a very old man, it's not Brit Milah on the right time. It's not a perfect mitzvah. It's not the perfect mitzvah. But when the boy is eight days old, that's a perfect mitzvah for the first time in history. Even when he circumcised Ishmael, the wild beast, was 13 years old. It's not a perfect mitzvah. He cannot do priyah. Brit Milah is two steps. Milah and priyah. Priyah you can only do when the baby is soft and young. Once he becomes a boy, that's it. There's no way to do priyah. That's why the circumcision can never be perfect. So now finally, for the first time in history, someone is going to perform a kosher circumcision according to God's rules. And you don't make a party, a meal, something, give wine, bread, something for the people, meat. What's going on here? No, who knows the answer? How can it be such thing? Why?
Maybe it was torturing for him, for Bob.
Now when we circumcise the babies, it's a torture for the baby, yes. The baby is screaming from the pain, yes. And we make a party, and we sing, and we serve food. Yeah, you know?
The oldest son, he was afraid of Ayin Hara, maybe?
Ayin Hara, being afraid of Ayin Hara, definitely it's not a reason to cancel any mitzvah, even the smallest mitzvah in the Torah. Ayin Hara, you know?
Do you want to make Ishmael jealous, maybe?
Why Ishmael should be jealous? He circumcised him also. You know, Ishmael and Yitzchak had later, after the years when Yitzchak grew up, Ishmael came to Yitzchak and said, I'm greater than you. And Yitzchak said, why are you greater than me? He said, you see, when you were circumcised, no, you couldn't say yes or no. You were a brand new baby. When I was circumcised, I agreed to be circumcised. I could run away. I could say to Avraham, I'm not interested. I'm 13 years old. I can get married now, 13 years old. Those days, the people used to get married in this age. You come and tell me what to do? I'm not interested. You take care of your own problem and leave me alone. But I agree. That's why I deserve better credit than you. So what's the answer? Yitzchak's circumcision was perfect according to God's rules. Perfect according to the rules, even if you did not have the right mind for it, it's better than to have the right mind and do the mitzvah wrong. Remember this. Many people do not know it. They think, as long as my intention is good, what difference does it make if I did the mitzvah correctly or not? Like a person wants to do, to buy tefillin. So he goes, they tell him 500, 700, 1,000, 2,000. So he buy the one for 2,000. He doesn't check. He say, oh, that's the best. The best. If it's the most expensive, for sure it's the best. He writes a check, $2,000, he buy it. Then after 3-4 years, he check it, it's not kosher. So how does a person comfort himself? I did everything right. I bought the best one. What is my problem? I every day put tefillin, I made the brachot, just like everybody else. What, I don't deserve the reward? So the answer is, he did not have one day of mitzvah tefillin in his life. Yes, he did everything supposedly correctly. The reality is that the mitzvah was never get done. If a word is missing from this tefillin, it's not a kosher tefillin. It's like putting this bottle of water on your arm. Not only that, it's even actually a sin every day. He's coming to do a mitzvah and he's making a sin. That making bracha on a non-kosher tefillin, it's a problem. So his name is saying the name of Hashem for no reason, because it's really not tefillin. It looks like tefillin. One letter is missing, that's it. It's not kosher. He doesn't know, he doesn't get punished for it. He did everything correctly. If he went and bought a pair of tefillin for $200-$300, he deserved the punishment. It's like going to buy a brand new Mercedes for $5,000. So I didn't know. It's not kosher. I didn't know. Why? You ever find a car like this for less than $40,000? Brand new, $5,000, you didn't know something is fishy here? Didn't know. You buy a pair of tefillin in cheaper than what the material costs. Forget about the labor. Just the material already costs more. And then you ask, oh, I didn't know it's not going to be kosher. Of course you knew. You wanted to save and you pay the price. You understand? I'm talking someone who paid generously, was not saving, and then in the end it wasn't good. So to give him a punishment for not putting tefillin, Hashem won't. Because after all, he tried to do it. But to give him the reward, like he put the mitzvah tefillin, he won't get. He will only get the reward of the efforts, of trying, or of the time that he wasted, yes, of doing it 5 minutes every day. So for that, he will get the reward. But the actual mitzvah, he doesn't have. What this mitzvah does in the afterlife to the soul, the doors that this mitzvah opened for you, he won't have. It's like a password. One digit is missing. The magnetic strip is not working. You have the card, but it's not working. You try to get cash out of the machine. You have $1,000,000 there, but it doesn't work. Or you don't know the password. It doesn't come out. Yeah, you have everything perfect. One little thing is missing. Finish. It's not working. So the answer is why he didn't make a meal. Because when a person is not Jewish yet, they are not Jewish yet before the circumcision. It's not like us. We're born to a Jewish mother, so we are, from the moment we come to the world, we already consider Jewish. It comes the circumcision and makes it perfect. It's like a final stamp. But it's not that we were not Jewish before. We are Jewish because the mother is Jewish and it's a Jewish soul. When Hashem decides what soul to put in a body, he can either bring a soul from this world or a soul from the world of the Goyim. And he brings the soul from the Jewish souls and he puts it in this baby. And now, if the circumcision wasn't done, so it's like taking a bottle that was empty and sealed it. There is water inside, but you sealed it. There's no way now to open it. You break the seal, you have the water again. Unless if it's an empty bottle. If it's an empty bottle, you can break, open the seal, doesn't matter. There's nothing in it. This is what it is. So it's like a restriction that is put on the baby until he's going to get circumcised. What happened if his father didn't circumcise him? Like we just spoke about circumcision before the lecture here, that in Germany the court made a law that it's illegal now to circumcise babies. You know how in Europe it is. One court decided, next thing it's going to be all over. Same thing they're fighting for years about slaughtering animals, if it's kosher, not kosher. It started in Switzerland and went to Mexico and almost to other countries, to Holland. They've been fighting back and forth. So far, they didn't win. They lost. But over here, the court in Germany made a decision. You're not allowed to circumcise the baby. Why? Nobody asked the baby. You perform an operation that, according to them, it's not necessary. Why? They don't believe in the Torah. The judges that sit in the secular courts all over the world, Israel, Germany, United States, England, they're all atheists, most of them. They're all anti-God. History always showed that the secular court is the biggest enemy of God. If you check the history, no one is a bigger enemy of God than the secular courts. That's why a Jew is not allowed to step there. You're not allowed to step there suing another Jew. Not allowed to step 1 minute inside. You're not allowed to put mezuzot there even. They want to put mezuzot in the Israeli court, or Supreme Court, or civil court, not allowed to give them mezuzot, not allowed to participate with them. Not allowed to put mezuzot, like putting mezuzot in a bathroom. Not allowed, it's disrespecting God. It's against the law to put mezuzot there. You understand? Judges should know, a judge that is Shomer Shabbat, that is acting as a judge in a secular court, cannot be a part of the minyan, even if he has a yarmulke and a beard. And he called himself a modern Orthodox judge, all the poskim in the world will tell you the same thing. It's not, you cannot count him as one of the minyan. Even if he's a very nice person. Why? The laws are against God. The laws that he has to judge people with are against the laws of God. Some of the laws are not against God. Some of them are against the Torah. I always give this example. If you have to judge a Jew, that stole. He violated a rule from the Torah, and it's also against the Constitution of the United States. You're not allowed to be a thief. But if a person was hungry and he went to a supermarket and stole a piece of bread, and they caught him, and now the police arrested him, and they bring him to court, and now the judge wants to send him to 3 months in jail for stealing from a store. What does the Torah say to do to him?
Pay double.
Pay double. How much a bread costs? $2? You have to pay $4 and let him go. So according to the Torah, he has to pay $4 and he's back on the streets. According to the American or the Israeli court, he can go to 3 months in prison and get abused for 120 days. Or even a year, depend. And in some countries, they chop his hand off, like Iran, and I don't know, some Arab countries. They can chop his, even if he's 7 years old kid that stole, they chopped his hand off. You know, I saw once an email in Iran, a kid stole bread. They put the car to drive on his hand. They put the hand on a towel, and the car drives on his hand, and the car with the wheel, very heavy car, and a 7 years old boy. The Torah says before 13, a person is not having a complete mind. And not judge him like an adult. Especially 7 years old is almost like a monkey. What do they know? Especially in this generation. In the previous generation, they were more mature. 7 years old kid, what do they know? You take away his hand for stealing bread? How do you know? Maybe he was starving. Maybe it was pikuach nefesh. Maybe it was a life risk. If it's a life risk, it's a mitzvah to steal bread. If it's a life risk, you can take your friend's car without permission and drive and do something if you are in a danger. Your life is in jeopardy. You're allowed to do anything you want with your friend's property and later pay it back. Don't need permission if it's a life risk. If it's an inconvenience, you don't feel comfortable, you're very hungry, but it's not a life risk, you're not allowed to steal. You have to ask permission in advance. If you know if you're not going to do it right now, in 1 hour you'll be dead, you don't have to ask permission. Some say you don't even have to return. Pikuach nefesh, canceling the mitzvah, you should not steal. The halacha is you should pay later back. Later you pay. But just to show you that what they do is against the Torah. Now you're a judge in a court. If you know the Torah, now you have to do something completely against God's wish. How are you going to ever pay back to this person that you send him to prison for 3-4 months? He lost his children. The children went off the way. They're not learning from now on. By the time he comes back home, the kids became who knows what. Started to smoke, drugs, problem, internet issues. There was no father in the house for a few months. For what? For stealing a piece of bread. Just show you on purpose an extreme contradiction between the Torah and the secular court. So just because you want to be a prestige judge and people bow down to you, and you have a career, doesn't justify to rebel against God. And there's many other examples like this. So the answer is right now is that Avraham Avinu, before they circumcised, they were not officially Jews. He was Avraham HaIvri, one-sided. Also Yitzchak. Only after the circumcision they become Jewish. So when a goy comes today to convert, what's the process? First, he goes through the learning. Once he's ready to pass the test and he passed the 50-question test, once he passed the test, what comes next? The circumcision. After the circumcision, they go into the mikveh. But if he goes into the mikveh, can he say a bracha? What's the bracha? Asher kidishanu b'mitzvotav etzivanu al ha-tvila. That God ordered me to go into the mikveh. Into the natural pool of water, natural water pool, but it's a lie. Hashem did not command the goy to go into the mikveh. The goy chose to be a Jew. The obstacle before becoming Jewish is circumcision and going into the mikveh, into the natural water. That's the obstacle. But it's not really, it's not an obligation. No one forced you to be a Jew. You can stay a goy. I want to be, it's like us. We don't have an obligation to slaughter animals. Can go all my life without slaughtering a cow once in my life, or a sheep. Don't have an obligation. Once I want to eat meat, it becomes an obligation. I don't eat meat, it's never going to be an obligation. I will never go in a forest. That's why probably I will never have shiluach haken. Ki yikare lecha ken tzipor, if you accidentally, there's no accident, of course, you go somewhere and you found a nest, and it's a kosher bird, and you want to get rid of the mother and take the babies, the chicks out. So if it happened, if it found you on your way, it become an obligation. If it didn't find you, you never did it. Some people go and search for it. There's no obligation to go search for it. That's why the Torah says, "Ki yikare lecha." Coincidentally, on your way, you found it. So the obligation is only once I want to do A, then I'm receiving an extra obligation on myself. Right? If I want to become a boss, now I already have an obligation, Beyomoti ten scharo, and I have to pay on time. I'll never be a boss. I'll never have an issue of paying on time to my workers. Never be a test for me. I'm just going to be a worker myself. You understand? One thing leads to another. A woman doesn't want to get married. No one can force her to get married. She doesn't want children. She wants to sit and learn all her life and read Tehillim. They say, "Hey, Miriam, why are you not getting married? I don't want this headache. I just want to be holy, a monk. Sit somewhere in a mountain all day, talk to Hashem, you know, have my own life, that's it. Live vegetarian life, live a natural life, don't want to get married." Can you prosecute her in a Jewish court from violating a sin, violating any mitzvah? No. A man does it, is violating the first mitzvah in the Torah of Pruvu, multiply and have children. If you have an obligation to multiply, you must get married first. The goyim don't need to get married. They can have children as much as they want without marriage. But a Jew must get married. And a Jew that wants to leave his wife, he has to give her divorce. By the goyim, it's in and out. You move in, you move out, finished. No need ceremonies. They copy everything from us, of course, but they don't need. Chris and Christine want to move in, fine. One day they want to move out, she say goodbye, she leaves the house, she's allowed to every man. Once she left the house, she took her stuff, she left, she's free again. You know? So, by the Jews, it's not the same case. You have to get married. So the question is, once you have an obligation to go into the mikveh and to circumcise yourself because you chose to be a Jew, right? You don't have to do a meal. You only do a meal in a Brit Milah when you are born Jewish. So the Milah, it's for the sake of Brit Milah, not for the sake of conversion. That's why Avraham Avinu never made the meal when he circumcised Yitzchak, even though it was the first kosher circumcision in history. First time he circumcised a baby that was 8 days old, it was Yitzchak. Everything himself and Ishmael was not on the right time. Milah shelo bizmana. There was no obligation. That's why he made the meal when he was born, but not when he circumcised him. Also, the Ben Ishchai writes, if a person is anxious to celebrate his birthday, it's not a good thing because it comes from Paro. He should celebrate the day of his circumcision. The day he was circumcised, it's like a holiday for him. So he should celebrate the day of his circumcision. Then, you know, the Chazal are teaching us that the ram that Avraham Avinu sacrificed instead of Yitzchak, once Hashem told him, don't touch Yitzchak. You know, this dialogue between Avraham Avinu and God is very, very critical in our days. Most people don't understand what they read. We read it in a prayer every morning. We don't really understand that we have a solid, legal argument here. A very solid legal argument. The Muslim comes and say, well, after the Jews disappointed God so many times, so he got tired of them. And now they have the obligation to prove themselves. That's why they have to build the mosque inside Beit HaMikdash. That's why they have the nerve, the chutzpah, to complain that the Jews dig under the mosque, under Arabite, to find some memory from the Holy Temple who used to be there 2,000 years ago. The Jews are finding another layer and another layer, so the Arabs are going crazy. So they're trying to destroy everything they can that the Jews will not come and look for some discoveries over there. But the Arabs themselves know that the Beit HaMikdash was there and this place belongs to the Jews. That's why they came to begin with to make the mosque over there. So how can you be such a hypocrite? How do you come and steal someone's house and then you pretend you never lived there? הרצחת וגם ירשת? First you murder, now you come and steal the house of the victim? So what's going on here? No, they have supposedly a legal excuse. They say, we didn't steal the house from you. God threw you out of here. You did not keep the covenant in the right way. That's why you lost your rights. The problem is that first I said in previous lectures that Hashem said to the Jews, He'll never replace them with any other nation. He'll severely punish them, but He'll never replace them with any other nation. So the argument is dismissed before it even started. But it gets even better. Here we find that Avraham Avinu went and took Hagar and had Ishmael. Ishmael is an Arab. Hagar was Egyptian. So Ishmael is the first Arab that we know about. Is Ishmael in Arabic. They use this name until today. So now Ishmael, Hashem comes to Avraham Avinu and says, take your son, your only son, the one you love, to sacrifice him to be a sacrifice to me. What is this? Take your son, your only son, the one you love. Why? What about Ishmael? Usually when a person has a son that is 13 and a son that is 8 days old, which one is more important? The older one, no? Mm-hmm. The older one is more important. It's the Bechor. First one. The Torah say, Lo Ya'adif. You're not allowed to take the one, if you have two wives, one you love more than the other, you're not allowed to dismiss the rights of the firstborn by choosing the secondborn, which is from another woman. They both firstborn. One from Rachel, one from Miriam. But Rachel is older. He is the real firstborn. No, you don't like Rachel so much, so you dismiss the rights of your firstborn. You go to the secondborn and you claim, what's the problem? It's also my firstborn from a different woman. The Torah says you're not allowed to do it. But here comes God to Abraham and He says, take your only son. And there's a verse in the Torah, a few verses, which means Ishmael doesn't count. Nothing. It's not your son for me. Yitzchak is your son. And then there's a clear verse, Be'itzchak ikare lechazera. Your descendants comes from Yitzchak only. So they read it inside the Torah. How can they continue with their lies? How they have the strength? You know, a liar, when he knows he's lying, there's a point that the lie is so big that he loses energy. Knowing you're such a liar, you don't have the energy to continue with the lie. Good lies, successful lies, even though all lies in the end will be revealed. That's the rule. It can take a year, 1,000 years, 5,000 years. Eventually all lies will come up, will be exposed. But a good lie will stand for a long time because it was built on truth foundation. You took the truth and you added lies on top of it. So some part of the story has truth in it. The truth makes the lie survive. But if the entire story is a lie, it will collapse right away. It won't last more than a week or two. The lie will only survive on the back of the truth. That's the rule. So they take some of the truth, and now they put all their lies on top of it. But when you see, you read inside the Torah that God, that you love so much, you scream, Allahu Akbar, God is great. You love Ibrahim, you love Ismail, you love Yitzchak. Yitzchak is also only in Quran. They're all big names for you, right? Mm-hmm. And now you come and you ignore verses from God's book? How can it be? And God said to Avraham, Yitzchak is your son, Ishmael is nothing for me. If I was a Muslim, I wouldn't need more than that. Even in elementary school, first grade, if my teacher would teach me this part of the Torah, and I would read this, and I know I came from Ishmael, and the Jews came from Yitzchak, I wouldn't need more than that. But 1.5 billion Arabs apparently don't see it. So you see that first of all, to see the truth, you need a special merit for it. Sometimes you speak to a Jew, 5 hours. What can be a bigger proof than that? The other person in 5 minutes saw the truth. This one, 5 hours, doesn't see anything. You need the merit. You need the merit to see the truth. It's not so simple. So the ram that Avraham sacrificed instead of Yitzchak, Chazal say, was ready from the creation of the world. Eilo shel Yitzchak. How many years since the creation of the world until Avraham Avinu? 2,000 years. When Avraham was 52 years old, the world was 2,000 years old. In 1948, to the creation of the world, 1948, Avraham Avinu started his life. And when he became 52 years old, 1948 plus 52, it's year 2000, he became a preacher. He started to make seminars. He opened the Kiruv organization, the first Kiruv organization, before I came around and all the great speakers. Avraham Avinu invented the concept of bringing people back. So he started to give, he had a lot of money. Money, it's a very important thing in Kiruv. Without it, there's not that much you can do. That's why I always try to encourage our wealthy brothers and sisters to wake up and use their money correctly. And sometimes it helps, most of the time it doesn't help. It can help for a week and then everyone goes back to their routine. So what's the point? The point, Avraham was a very wealthy man. Today, for instance, Bin Laden was a very wealthy man. Avraham was a very wealthy. Avraham decided to do something good with his money. To build world of love, of bringing people close to God, appreciation, bless God, appreciate the food, do great things. The other monster decided to take his $1 billion and only murder people and create hate and everything in his life about hate and ugliness and bitterness and racism. It's all a free choice. One person can do good with his money, second one is use the same money to destroy the world. So Avraham Avinu used this ram. The ram was 2,000 years old. Actually more. When Avraham Avinu was born in 1948, in the time of the circumcision, he was 99. So it was 2,047 years. The world was 2,047 years. From the creation, from Adam until the day of Yitzchak's circumcision. So this ram was 2,047 years old. Did you ever see a ram like this that is very old? Obviously, it's a spiritual ram. Yeah. It wasn't a regular sheep that you have or whatever. 2, 3, 5 years later, it becomes shish kebab on your table. Mm-hmm. We're talking a very special ram that was prepared for this day. So the answer is, we have a problem now. We have a rule. You cannot sacrifice an animal that is older than 2 years old. Almost all the sacrifices in Torah is 1 year old. When it's soft, delicious meat. You do it right. 2 years maximum, 2 years old. This was 2,000 years old. So how Avraham sacrificed it? No. What do you think?
What the Torah was given, yeah.
Huh?
What the Torah was given.
The answer is, when something was created by Hashem, it didn't come from a mother and father. Created by Hashem, it never gets old. It stays just like the day he was born. You understand? This is what confused the scientists. When Hashem created the world, they check, they do all kinds of measurements, it looks like the world is billions of years old. The Ari said, the world was created old. Sometimes the scientist comes and say, the world has to be billions of years old. Why? The light travels 300,000 kilometers per second. Per second, multiplied by 60, 300,000 by 60 is 18 million, 300,000, wow, 180, no, 18 million per minute, 18 million per minute. Multiplied by 60 per hour, it's already billions. Multiplied by 24 hours, it's trillions. Multiplied by 365 days, it's a number from here to Tel Aviv. That's how fast the light travels in 1 year. And you have galaxies, stars, 500 years of light. 500 years of light. The distance between one to another. Which means, when we see a star, we see the star many, many years after it arrived to us. So far. So many billions of miles away, that how did it reach in 5,000 years to here? How did it get here? It had to be that it was traveling for more than 5,000 years. 100,000 years, a million years. It cannot be only 5,000 years or 6,000 years, right? Is this a question? Is this a challenge? Not at all. When the world was created, it was all created as a perfect system. There's no processes that were created in the middle or in the beginning and started to develop. Everything was into its place. So if Hashem wanted us to see billions of stars in the sky, and some of them are so far away, He created them with their lights, was sent all the way to heaven. Not that He created them 500,000 years away from us, and now they started to send their light. Of course, they would never reach here. What's the point of making them if we'll never see them? He already created them with their light, with the reflection that arrived to Earth right away, which with a huge line. It's like a flashlight. If I want to go like this, and I create a flashlight, but the flashlight is off, and now I turn it on, and I want to send it to a million miles away, the light, when I turn it. It will take a few seconds until it will get to the other side of the planet, no? But if I created the flashlight on with the light already, what's the question? So they create from nothing, they create arguments. But Hashem created the world already ready to go. Just like before Adam sins, the plan was that a person will be born like 20 years old. No baby, no diapers, no teaching him to walk, kindergarten, pacifier, none of these things. Person is born, right away play basketball. Right away. Comes out, where is the ball? Relax. Come, eat your first steak. Everybody has teeth, everything. After the sin, the world has changed. So the person can be created 20 years old. How old is he, 20 years old? No, he's 1 day old. 1 hour old. But he looks, you examine him now, you take him to the doctor. Let's see a miracle like this would happen. And someone will be born 20 years old. Walking, talking, running, jumping, muscles. You take him to a doctor. Ask the doctor, examine him. Tell me how old he is. The doctor would say, probably 20, 21. Say, no, he's 1 hour old. We'll never believe you. We can't blame him. But that's not no question here. So he was ready to go for the day that he will be sacrificed, ready from the moment he was created, exactly to this moment. Then we have a rule. This is a very important rule. People who are on the way to do mitzvah, you're on the way to do a good deed, you have a special insurance, special protection. Insurance is not the right word. Special protection. Why? What's the difference between protection and insurance? Insurance, you get damage, and later you get the check to pay you for your damage. But in the meantime, you lost your car. You cannot say you didn't lose your car. Protection, it's like a shield. Someone is about to blow your car, and it's a special protection. The car doesn't get damaged. Someone shoot at the car, it doesn't go in. Someone threw a bomb, the car is not getting damaged. It's a special protection, a shield. So the Gemara said that if someone is on the way to do mitzvah, enam nizokim, does not get damaged. That's the word of Chazal, of the sages. But I can give you hundreds of cases that people every day on the way to do mitzvah get damaged. Every week we hear on the news. This guy was on the way to Achnasat Sefer Torah. The whole family went in a big accident, died. Now remember, on the way to do the mitzvah, you cannot get damaged, and on the way back. But we cannot deny reality. Can't close your eyes and say, I don't care. Whatever Chazal say, fine. Whatever reality, doesn't exist. You have to try to find a way to justify both ways. So how does it work? Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. It says like this. Yosef HaTzadik, Joseph, he died the youngest from his brothers. He died 110 years old. Everyone else died older than him. There's few explanations why. Kibud Orim, he was away from his father for many years, fine. He got smo barabanut. He acted as a rabbi. It's not good to run after this job. Better not to get this job. Sometimes people run after personal position. It's not good. So there's reasons for it. But the question is, Yaakov sent Yosef to look for the brothers. When your father sends you in a hot of the mid, in a hot weather of the Middle East, remember there's no GPS, no radars, no telephones, no way to find them. You have to go around, you have to ask people. It's a very, very difficult job. Go find where they are now. So he ran from one place to the other, he's looking for his brothers until he found them. What did they do? They threw him in a pit, they slaughtered a goat. Next thing he found himself as a slave in Egypt. So how did he get damaged? If he was on his way to do mitzvah, his father sent him to do a mitzvah, he respects his father. Your father sent you to buy him something kosher. You run and you do it for your father. You're very lazy, you don't want to do it. You prefer to lay down and relax now, or to read a book. In a hot humidity of the Middle East, you run now, you're looking for what he wants. You're not happy from this, and you do it because it's an obligation. Torah says, respect your father and mother. Now on the way, you get mugged, or someone break your bones. Then you wonder, what's going on here? I don't understand. There is a special protection. I mean, I'm busy with a mitzvah. There's few rules. When a person is busy with the mitzvah, first, he has this shield, this protection not to get damaged. Second, he's dismissed from another mitzvah. You're busy with one mitzvah, you're dismissed with another. As long as you're busy with this mitzvah, you're busy with burying a person that doesn't have who to make him a funeral. So you come, you pay for the grave, you dig the grave, you take the body, you take care of this whole thing. While you were doing it, there was tefillat shachrit. You had a morning prayer. But since he died at 4 in the morning, and you took him, and this, you were taking off this entire thing, you missed the only minyan in your town. So you pray at 10 o'clock. You usually pray at 7. Since you're busy with the mitzvah, you couldn't do another mitzvah. So, ha'osek b'mitzvah, patur min ha'mitzvah. You're busy with one mitzvah, you patur with another mitzvah. There's rules applies to it, if other people can do the mitzvah or not. But there are rules about it. The Torah is very realistic, very logical. So Hashem wanted people to always feel safe when they do the mitzvah, so he gave them a special protection. Ha'osek min ha'mitzvah is enam nizokim, shluchei mitzvah. A messenger of a mitzvah, you're on the way to do a mitzvah, you have a special protection. So the question is, why Yosef got damaged? It's a proof in the Torah. I cannot say he wasn't. They took him, they threw him in a pit with scorpions and snakes. Next thing, they sold him to the Arabs, Midianim, and to the Arabs, and took him to Egypt, 17 years old, became a slave, went to jail. The answer is, damage, reward and punishment is nothing instant. What look right now the most horrible day of your life can actually be the best day of your life. You just don't see the process. You only checked your life momentarily. It's a very common mistake that we do all the time. Today your stock is up, so you're dancing. You're full. What are you dancing? Did you sell it? When you cash, when you take the cash in your hand, dance. Right now it's up 20%. Tomorrow it's going to be a crash, you'll be down 50%. All this dancing was for nothing. Or the other way around. Today you're 40% down, you pull your hair off. Facebook came out, whoop, right away 50% went down, 40%. Then it came up 10%. So the people who bought it, before it went down 5% more, they were pulling their hair off. Wow, just invested $1 million and it went down to $950,000, down $50,000 in 2 days. 3-4 days later, he went up 10%. Now he's up 50,000. What was the crying for? It was all a waste of time. Burning your heart for nothing. Or dancing for nothing. When Yosef went to look for the brothers, they were very cruel to him. They threw him to the pit, snakes. Then they sold him. Poor Yosef lost his father. There was no emails, no Skype. Hi, Father Yaakov, how are you? Don't worry, I'm in Egypt. I eat well. Tomorrow we'll chat again on a Skype. It was a different world. You're gone, you're gone. You missed, you never see your father. You're done, they'll never see you. They don't know where you are. It's a big world. So just the feeling is horrible. But in the end, it was all a part of his way to the highest level in the pyramid. Became the leader of the world. In reality, it was even greater than Paro. Once Paro gave him the ring, the stamp, when you control all the money, you know how they say in Hebrew, Ba'al ha-me'ah u'ba'al ha-de'ah. If you have the rabbi in a synagogue and the president who built the place and paid the salaries, who really make the final decision? Can be a big rabbi, big Talmid Chacham, everyone kisses his hand. Bottom line, when he says something they don't like, they kick him out of the window. That's what's happening today. What happened? Why you fired the rabbi? He spoke about modesty, and I don't like it. Why? Because his wife go with the skirt all the way up to her knees. All the way up. So the rabbi says something from the Shulchan Aruch or from the laws that bothered him or embarrassed him. Next thing, you find a reason to get rid of him. Doesn't come on time. Not always say the real reason. You understand? So the only really successful shuls are the ones that the rabbi also built the place. He's the real president. He hires someone to run the place, but he's his messenger. He can fire the president, not the president can fire him. It's very unhealthy that you have a president and he controls the rabbi. It's against Hashem. Usually the presidents are ignorant. They don't know anything. How can an ignorant person tell the rabbis what to do? It's an embarrassment for the Torah. It's against Hashem's will. According to the Torah, if the rabbi comes to 47th Street and he brings merchandise from Israel, all the Bukharians have to fold their boot for the entire day until he sells all his merchandise. You know that? The rabbi showed up from Israel now. He brought $100 million diamonds. The Bukharians, they didn't sell anything for a week already. They're dying to make a sale. Hop, all of a sudden, this Chacham came, Rosh Yeshiva. I'm also a businessman. I gotta make a living. One has to scream. Please, everyone fold their business. They don't send all the customers to his booth. Once he sells his merchandise, he goes, we kiss his hand, thank you for coming, be my guest. Now they open their merchandise. Tomorrow there's a war, they don't go to the army. You collect taxes, most of the taxes they're dismissed. Some taxes they have to pay. Most taxes they dismiss. If they now want to collect a tax to guard the city, for instance, now in Israel, they need the protection against the rockets. Baruch Hashem, Uncle Sam is contributing now. But let's say Israel had to pay $100 million for each truck that they put. So very expensive. So they have to collect it from the taxpayers. The rabbis are dismissed. You don't collect from them any. Now they make a special tax. 5% more from your annual income to pay for those protection against the rockets. According to the Torah, and I'm allowed to come to the Talmidei Chachamim and say pay the extra tax to protect the city. Why? Why? Because the rockets are falling because of the ignorant people who don't learn Torah and make sins. The kosher people who learn Torah and don't make sins, they are another reason for the rockets to come. That's why Hashem say they dismiss. They don't have to pay this special tax. To make roads and things that they use, fine. But security tax? I'm not the reason the rockets fall here. The Gemara say there was the king, the Roman Caesar, wanted to buy himself a special jewel. Let's say worth $500,000. So he came to the Jews, Rebbe was in charge. I think it was in Tzipori or in Tiberias. And he said to them, you have X amount of time to buy me this jewel. Collect from all the Jews from your city, collect tax, and I want you to buy me a special present. That's how it was in those days. Imagine now, let's say Obama, he decided that Israel has to buy him a $5 million jewel. You don't buy me, I cut the $2.5 billion aid that I give Israel. What can you do? You gotta buy him the jewel. What can you do? Unless if you trust Hashem to give you replacement for what he gives, right? That's the idea. Now with them, it's not they cut you out. They come and kill you. You don't have to, you have to do it. So guess what happened? So Rebbe said, only the business people have to pay the tax. The people who learn Torah don't have to pay anything. So the business people got angry. All the lawyers, the doctors, all the jewelry businesses, they all came and said, we're going to leave town. If you make such prejudice laws, you dismiss the yeshiva guys and we have to pay all the tax, we leave town. Let's see how the rabbis will pay this tax on their own. So he told them, you're more than welcome. Take your stuff and leave town. half of them left town. Now came the other half. They said, Rabbi, we agree in first place to pay, but now 50% of the workers left. We're going to have to pay the tax for them? It's not fair. Tell the rabbis to participate. Rabbi said, no, you'll pay all the tax. So we leave town also. So, no problem, go ahead. They packed their stuff and they left. So only the town left with only people who sit and learn Torah. Not one businessman left. An hour later, a messenger came on a horse and said, the king changed his mind, doesn't want the jewel. Why the Gemara brings this story? Who brought us this penalty to town that we have to lose so much? The people who don't learn Torah. They make sins with the ladies. They do bad stuff. Hashem gets angry. He sends a collective punishment to the entire town. Once they got out of town, why to punish the rabbis? They learn Torah. They do what I told them to do. I'm not interested to punish them. The punishment was for the ones who have to pay the tax. They don't want to pay. No problem. Let them run away. And in the end, they got dismissed. And the story appears in the Talmud to teach us that this is exactly how it works. That's why they dismiss for certain things. Let's move on. So Yosef got supposedly damaged. No, that damage was the greatest thing happened to him. Thanks to that, he became the king of the world, the treasury. All the money in the world in his hands. He decided to give his family. He had the power to bury his father Yaakov in Eretz Israel. He was in a very important things. Actually, his children, Ephraim and Menashe, had special rights. Not only Shevet Levi. The tribe of Levi, Levi lived 137 years old. The oldest tribe. Why? He was learning Torah. Kiyem chayenu v'orech yamenu. When you learn Torah, you have longer life. Look at all the rebbes. I don't think there's one rebbe that is younger than 90 in the day passed away. All of them. The rebbe from Vishnitz was 95. Rav Steinman, that should live long life, 100 years old. Rav Eliashiv, 102. Rav Ovadia, 93. Rav Voisner in his 90s. Rav Chaim Kanievsky in his 90s. And Rav Kaduri was 107. Rav Shach was 106. They all lived to ages that are very hard to find today. And also Yitzhak Shamir lived 96 years old and died yesterday. You know who was Yitzhak Shamir? The Prime Minister of Israel. Why Yitzhak Shamir lived long life? What was his merit? I have a suggestion. From all the prime ministers of Israel, the only one who never feared the goyim and never surrendered to them was Yitzhak Shamir. Never, ever. He never surrendered to them. All the political pressure of the Americans, all the threats, we cut the budget, we won't approve, nothing moved him an inch. The Lubavitcher Rebbe liked him very much. He sent him once a letter. Up to now you were perfect. You did not give one inch of the Holy Land to the Goyim. But now I'm encouraging you. Don't be afraid of them. They were always after us for the last 2,000 years. They always want everything, the little that we have. Nothing will ever change. Don't surrender. He did not surrender in his time. Never. Once he passed away, came Menachem Begin, which was a righteous prime minister, was Shomer Shabbat, was a good man. And he was a great fighter in the beginning of Israel, but he wasn't a strong character. He surrendered to Egypt and gave them 2/3 of Israel. And a week ago, we just found out that it was a waste of everything. Here, the Muslims took over. They don't want to even meet Bibi Netanyahu. Don't want to meet with him, don't want to answer the phone. It's all over, this supposedly peace. The Israeli politicians, the seculars, don't understand the root of the problem. They think that the problems between us and the Arabs is a political issue. That's why they're trying to solve it in political-ish manners. Political comes and correct political problems. Like the British and the Argentinians. They fight about the Auckland Islands. That's a political issue. Who owns it? Shnaim ochazin betalit. It's mine. No, it's half mine. It's half yours. It's all mine. It's an argument about a jewel, about a piece of land. And two neighbors fighting about the wall. If it's 5 feet to my territory or to yours. They come to court. They bring the deeds, proofs, witnesses. They compromise. End of story. That's a political issue. Over here, it's a religion issue. They made a fake religion who comes against the Torah. That's all. They claim that they're second parts of the Torah and they complete the Torah and they continue the Torah, but in reality, they do the opposite of what the Torah says. So when two religions collide, you will never have peace, because they are fanatic in their fake belief, and we are fanatic in the truth belief, the ones that God gave us. It belongs to us, the land. I'm the master of the land. So how are you going to make peace? In order for you to make peace, you have to eliminate at least one of the two religions. And we both know it's not realistic. The Muslim won't give up their religion, and we for sure won't give up ours. After 3,000 years we survived, when everyone was trying to destroy us, we have no plan to give up religion. The opposite. Baruch Hashem, many Jews are waking up to become religious. And they're also becoming more fanatic. So how do you even waste time on seeding and making political agreements? What are you wasting time for? No, there's no point. There's no point. It will never end. And anyone who thinks that the Arabs have problems with Israel because they occupy the land and all this nonsense, it's all baloney. Even you give them now Israel and say, okay, let's move to Texas. Give us a piece from the desert, I don't know, in Arizona. We'll make ourselves a little state the size of Manhattan. We'll squeeze. We'll come after you over there. What do you think? Look in the United States. Everywhere the Jews live, what comes right next to them? The Arabs. Go to Coney Island. The Jews occupied Brooklyn. Right away, the Arabs came, the Muslims. Muncie. Next to it, Spring Valley, everywhere, halal meat, this, that. Everywhere you go. New Jersey, right, a town or two next to it. Oh, that's how it is. Israel, Ishmael, it's a conflict that until the time of Mashiach will never be resolved. So what we have to do, the Zohar say, the way to resolve the problem is to make peace with our father. That's it. Then this problem will be dismissed by itself. You won't make peace with me, Hashem say. I'm sending this wild beast after you and you'll never have a rest. Never. No matter what you're going to do. You buy another 500 F-16 bombers. Won't help you. You buy protection, rockets, make agreements, give whatever, nothing. Maybe you get a year of a little bit quiet. And that's it. It's going to start right back. It starts from kindergarten. 2 years old, they already teach them how to slaughter the Jews. What do you think they teach in kindergarten in Gaza or in Iran? Itbach el Yahud. They love this sentence so much. For birthday, they sing, murder the Jews, murder the Jews, put bombs. My dream is to explode and kill some women and children. That's their education. Everywhere in the world, I show you hundreds of films like this. They ask little Ahmed, tell me, what's your dream when you grow up? To blow up in Kapulski in Tel Aviv and kill 20 Jews with me. They think, they believe, they go to heaven, brainwash them. And it's very interesting because it's not even according to the Quran. Even the Quran doesn't say to do it. Really, in reality, the Quran say only allowed to kill people in a war, face to face. Not to go and kill innocent people. Even Jews are not allowed to kill. But they do whatever they want. They care about the Quran, really. They care in Saudi Arabia, all these sheikhs that supposedly look religious. You know what they do over there? Show you some articles what happened in their palaces with all the models that they hire to make their scenes over there. Close parties. Those are the ones who make the religious laws. Those are the ones who execute sinners. It's very interesting. The one who sent someone to death now is a million times bigger sinner than this one. You understand? We cannot be like this. You sit in a court, you're going to send someone to death or to prison when you know you're worse than him. How can you sit there? Resign.
What if you do jury?
Find an excuse. Say you're sick. You cannot be a judge.
What if you do jury duty?
Jury duty? You have to do everything you can to avoid it. How are you going to participate against the laws of God? Now, what happens if he's a Jew who they want to send to prison for 10 years because he stole $50,000. You're allowed to participate in such a crime? You're allowed to vote yet to send him to prison when you know that according to God he has to pay $50,000 fine and go back on the street? You're allowed. You're not allowed. If they're now in a court, they want to make a law against circumcision, like in Germany. Tomorrow they want to do it in America. So they call you to jury duty. You have to sit there and you have to vote with the jury duty if it's a violation of the baby's right that he will be circumcised when he's 8 days old. And you have to now vote for something like this. Plus, sitting in a secular court, whether it's Jewish or not, or Goyim, it's already Chilul Hashem. So already Chilul Hashem. But that's besides the point. So let's move on. So Yosef did not get a damage. That's why Rabbi Yochanan Kohen Gadol, which was 8 years old, every year he goes into Kodesh HaKodashim, supposedly he's the holiest man in the land. Imagine, like the chief rabbi of Israel became secular, left the religion. Why? He saw a person climbing on a ladder and doing the mitzvah of Shiluach HaKen. He sends the bird from the nest and take the chicks away, and he fell from the ladder and died. The Torah said, if you do this mitzvah, you have long life. A person climbed on a ladder, did the mitzvah, and died. So he decided that something doesn't make sense here, and he went off the way. So the question is, why Rabbi Yochanan, which was a big, knowledgeable person, wasn't a beginner? How something like this shook his entire foundation? Why did not become secular when he read the story of Yosef? That Yosef was on the way to call his brothers and he ended up putting him in a pit and destroyed his life, supposedly. The answer is because with Yosef it was a happy end. And with us, in life, many things that looks like tragedy, we do not know, so we cannot jump to conclusion. What looks very bad right now, a person is very sick. Every day he has problems, shots, diabetes, medication, limitation. It looks horrible. One day he dies, Hashem says, you know what? How many things I saved you thanks to your illness? You got rid of all your sins from your previous life. You got rid of all the sins since you were secular all the 30 years of your life. So the last 10 years that you were sick, everything got wiped out. I dismiss your murder case. I dismiss your rape case. I dismiss 5,000 Shabbat that you did not keep. I dismiss this. I dismiss that. I gave you children. You're not supposed to have children, but I gave you 3 children. This is all because of this sickness. So a person would say, oh God, I wish you'd send me another sickness. You were so generous for the shot that I get every day and some limitations. You gave me so much. I didn't know I'm earning so much. Next time, give me more. So is that a tragedy or is it a great thing? It's a great thing. You just don't see. But here, Rabbi Yochanan said, wait a minute. How can we explain such a thing? Person fell and died. That's it. It's not a beginning of a process that in 5 years is going to be the leader of Egypt. But he made also a mistake. Chazal said, what was his mistake? First of all, to die, it's good or bad? Depends who you are. Chazal says, the Zohar says, that the soul is doing everything it can not to return back to the world. The soul doesn't want to come back to this dirty world, spiritually. To go from the upper world to this filthy world. But it's very interesting. But after the soul is in a body for 80 or 70, 80 years, when the soul separates from the body, the Zohar says there's nothing harder for the soul than the separation from the body. It reminds me about me when I joined the army. First day I went to the army, I was the most depressed person in the universe. Shaved my head, gave me all kinds of dirty uniforms. Not dirty, it's after laundry, but you see, you look at that right away, you get very depressed. Blanket full of dust. Put you 46 people in a room like sardines. No privacy whatsoever. Bathroom clogged, swimming pools all over. Food, I don't want to tell you, eating dog is more delicious than the food that they serve they have cans. You open, you have meat with preservative, 5 years it's in a can. Did you ever eat meat 5 years old in a can? I don't have to tell you when you open it, what happened? You have 10 soldiers around, 9 fainting. You need a mask when you open it up. very, very serious depression. You come from free life, you walk, you this, you swim on the beach, you do things. Nobody tells you what to do. All of a sudden you become a servant, so you're very depressed. Nobody wants to join the army. Everyone wants to be free. And then after 3 years, the day that I went, they made a mistake by a week by me. I was supposed to go a week earlier. I didn't even tell them. I was happy. So, very good, I'll be here another week. Once you get used, you get comfortable inside the bathroom, you don't suffer from the smell anymore. That's exactly what's happened. The soul is in the upper world with great perfume smells over there. Clean, nice, shiny. Doesn't want to come to the bathroom. Who wants to move from a Beverly Hills palace into a bathroom, public bathroom? You know anyone like that? Once a person is already in the bathroom for a few hours, doesn't smell anymore. You saw the people who clean the mirrors in the bathroom, in hotels, how they whistle. They sing, hey, como esta, señor? They hand you the napkins, you put $1 in the bath, all day. They don't even make $100, but they're so happy inside. See, that, enjoying them in the moment. Take him 1 hour out, bring him back in, the smile got wiped out. That's what happened to the soul. To come here, the soul in is a pure place, it recognizes the dirt here, doesn't want to come in. Once he's here, it got used to the bathroom, doesn't want to die. That's what happened, that's what the Zohar says. So, Shluchei mitzvah enam nizokim, there's one more explanation. People on the way to do mitzvah, they are not damaged from the actual mitzvah. But if they have pending punishments against them, of course they deserve to pay for it. So why Hashem brings it 1 hour after you did the mitzvah, or while you're on the way to do the mitzvah, or on the way back? Why? It looks like because I went to do a mitzvah, now I got punished. How else you want Hashem to test us? If it won't be like this, everything will be very clear. You believe in me or no? I said, when you come to do a mitzvah, you will never get damaged. Never. You gave donation, tomorrow you got fired. It's not because you gave donation, like some foolish ladies keep telling me all the time. Every 2-3 months, she gets her temper. It seems to me that every time I give tzedakah, I begin to lose. And I say to her, don't be a fool. Hashem is not a liar. No matter what you see, Hashem is not a liar. Hashem says, for the tzedakah, I will reward you for eternity. That's it. End of story. It's not open for debate. It's not a debate in the Congress. What should we vote? It's the word of the creator of the world. You give tzedakah, I will reward you big time. But in the meantime, I give 5 times tzedakah. Every time I give, I lose a big customer. I'm afraid to give. You're afraid to give because you're anti-God. You have no emunah in me, not even 1%. What is it like? The Israeli jet pilots, when they join the Air Force, rule number one, before they go for the first time to the air, no matter what you see, you always follow your screen. Never your intuition, never your beliefs, never your understanding. Always what the screen say, the computer, the real. Nothing what you feel, nothing. What you hear, what you feel, what you see, what looks down, up. Ignore reality. Reality doesn't exist when you're a pilot. You always stick to what the computer shows you. And many pilots in history ignored this important rule and crashed into the ocean or into the mountains and died. Why? It's called vertigo. If you go above if you battle with another plane and you go and you break left, right, and you goes around, you lose your location. You don't know where you are. You're up, you're down, you're upside down, you're on side, you don't know. Because you look down, it all looks blue. You look up, it's all blue. Everywhere is blue. There's nothing. You don't see mountains, you don't see land, you don't see buildings. You're above somewhere in the ocean. Everywhere you look, it looks blue. Now you may be flying upside down, but you don't really know it. Because they have a special pressure point that when they're upside down, that the blood don't go into the brain, so it shrinks. It's very interesting system how it works to prevent G, to prevent the brain from exploding from the pressure of the blood. So they don't really feel if they're upside down or not. So if they look at a computer, the computer always show you if you're upside down or straight. But some of them are sure, I went 3 times around. 1, 2, 3, which means I'm upside down, but really straight. So he goes up or down, and instead of going up, he goes into the water. Next thing, he goes full force into 1,000 feet into the water, and he dies. It happens a lot. So Hashem is like our Rio, the screen. Hashem say, you give tzedakah, you just made fortune. Guarantee. Guarantee. I'm not some businessman who promise you all kinds of business opportunity, or your stockbroker who plan how he robbed your commission. I'm not like this. If I told you, you give, you earn, it's guaranteed, it was wired to life of you, to your life of eternity. Guarantee. From the actual giving, that's one wire. Then comes an annual wire, every Rosh Hashanah, and add an extra bonus. What came out of your donation? First giving, you just wrote $1,000 check, you gave. Rabbi, here, make 1,000 CDs. Give it out. Before Rabbi even made one CD, it's still in his pocket, $1,000. You died. And he died. You already have this mitzvah. No man, nothing was done with that. By giving, you already earned a fortune wire. Now, a year later, assume everything was fine, he didn't die, and he made the CDs, and everything went out. Hashem collects and sends a wire every year to you, besides the actual huge wire that you already got by signing up. Every year in Rosh Hashanah, another $1 trillion. Spiritual, eternal money, not temporary money. That when you die, the IRS take half. And with the other half, your children buy drugs. Not this kind of money. The money that stays with you forever. You cash on it forever. That's why it's very hard for people to do it. Nah, the Satan will let you do it. No matter what, it will always push you to not so important investment. They have little wires. The Satan say better he get a small wire than a big wire. What can I do? Let me push him to a bad investment. This is how it works. And just before we finished, do you think that in history there was a person that ever reached 100% level of faith and confidence in God? Can you name a person like this in the entire history, from the Bible, from the Torah, from reality, your friends, your uncle, anyone you can name?
The one who got dressed up, he got stoned and he died. I forgot his name. He
dressed up? Dressed up?
He has a priest, and
Well, he dressed up as a priest because someone told him if he dressed like a priest, we'll give you all the money you need to marry the orphans. So he said, I don't mind embarrassing my friend as long as they give me the money to marry the orphan girl. That's not an indication that he has 100% faith. He had a nice amount of faith. 100%. Do you think David HaMelech had 100% faith?
No.
Ups and downs, yes,
he's
ups and downs.
Moshe Rabbeinu, you think reached that level or no?
Close.
Abraham Avinu.
He was close, but he didn't
close.
Reach.
Amram, I suppose. Abraham Avinu, we know for sure not. Why did he have to say Sarah is his sister? The Ramban say it was a problem with Emunah. So he's off the hook. Who do you think had... remember, 90% is an amazing amount. I'm talking 100%. 100%. Yitzchak is very interesting. From the three fathers, it's rated Yaakov, and then Avram, and then Yitzchak last. So a few proofs by certain verses in the Torah. Not that he wasn't a giant holy man, of course. But if you have to rate the three, that's Yaakov, Bechir Avot, Avram, and then Yitzchak. Eliyahu Navi? Eliyahu HaNavi, there was also a problem with him. He got punished. He had to come to every Brit Milah. So who? Let's talk about Moshe. Moshe is the best candidate. Moses, no? Why? He spoke to God face to face. Nobody reached this level. Face to face, not in a vision or in a dream. A dream always leaves 1% doubt. But face to face, if I talk to my best friend on the phone, I know it's his voice. I know his accent. I know the way he talks. I know the way he breathes. But I still have 1% doubt. Maybe it's a professional imitation. I don't know, maybe a machine. There's all kind of, I always have some kind of a doubt. I have to sign my life on it, I will think before. It's enough that I hesitate 5 minutes before I sign if it was my best friend or not. It's already show that I don't have 100% confidence. But if I'm face to face with him, 20 years I know him, I see him face to face, I don't have this hesitation. It's a different story. So Moshe reached this level. And Moshe didn't have 100% emunah. Who can give me the proof in the Torah? No, hit the rock, it's not a problem. He did what everyone would have done. Because remember, he wanted to do more than what Hashem asked him to do. That's not a problem with emunah. They're just not following the instructions 100%. Hashem told him, go to this rock, speak to the rock. Datan and Aviram gather everyone and make jokes. He's a shepherd. He knows every rock here. Let's see you giving us water from this rock. Then we'll bow down to you. So he said, well, for Hashem it doesn't matter. This rock, that rock. For Hashem it's a problem. Let me get them the water from here and I have a peace of mind from these wicked demonstrations all the time. So he went to this rock. He spoke to the rock. Nothing came out. One drop, two drops. Then he got angry and he hit the rock and the water came out. But the 1 minute that everyone was laughing on the floor, you see? That was a Chilul Hashem. That's already big. For that, he didn't enter the land. One of the 5 reasons. It's not even a sin. It's a sin. If I mean to sanctify the name of Hashem and give out of my time and my agony and my efforts, and in the end the opposite happened, it's a sin. Even if it's a sin, it's a not intentional sin. Everyone would agree that I'm not a wicked person. Meaning well and bad came out, right? You come to do Kiddush Hashem, and accidentally Chilul Hashem came out. No one will punish you. No one would say, hey, don't come to Daven with us. The opposite, people would admire you. They right away will forgive you, right? That's the way we are. I mean, he meant well. What do you want from him? He came to help you. But Moshe, who can give me the proof from the Torah that Moshe didn't have 100% faith in Hashem? No, the Ten Commandments he did right. Hashem told him, Yishar Kochecha. He said, they don't deserve. They worship an idol. I'll give them a reward, the Ten Commandments. They don't deserve to live. What Ten Commandments?
It's the burning bush when he says that they won't believe me.
They won't believe me that he didn't have faith in them, not in Hashem.
I think when he said to Hashem, why did you send me here? Because things got worse after he sent them.
That's a very good point. That's already one indication. Very good, but there's a better proof than that. When Moshe came in front of Pharaoh, Hashem told him, throw your stick. And he threw the stick, and it turned into a snake. What's the next verse? He got scared and he ran away from the snake. Wow. Hashem told you, throw it, it's going to be a snake. You throw, you see a snake, you run away from the snake. Ma, you don't trust Hashem to save you from the snake? Shtadlush, my Shtadlush. Hashem send you on a mission. Hashem's gonna ruin his plan. You stand in front of Pharaoh, he's gonna make him, Hashem would make himself look like a clown in front of Pharaoh. I'm sending my son, and I tell him, don't worry, if this boy will try to fight with you, I'm there, I'm watching. I will protect you. Go. So the boy comes, and then this boy gave him a smack, and I'm standing over there and hiding. I defeated my own purpose. Hashem sent him.
Hashem sent him. Right.
Right. Yes. Yes. From Shmuel, we learn Ishtadlus. Right. He's right, the rabbi. If Shmuel said, if he's going to hear, if Shaul is going to hear, he's going to kill me. But the Gemara doesn't give the same excuse. The Gemara says, from here we learn. Not about Ishtadlut. From here we learn that Echad Deshchicha Hezeka, you have to do Ishtadlut. And if it's a place that guaranteed to have a damage, don't count on Hashem miracles to save you. Don't count on it. But over here, he comes, he speaks to Paro, like two politicians. Even Arafat came to New York, even though Rudy Giuliani could not stand him. But he couldn't prevent him from coming into the United Nations. And Ahmadinejad comes here, is the biggest enemy of America. Instead of killing him, they send the FBI to protect him. Poor soldiers, the American soldiers, they have to defend this wicked midget. I just can't believe it. It's like, you know, like you can't, this is what Hashem said to the Satan. I allow you to do to Yov whatever you want, but make sure you don't take his soul out. So Chazal compare it, it's like taking a snake to protect a barrel, but without taking the honey from it, or something like that. All right, let's finish with this. So even Moshe was afraid from the snake. I once asked a person, tell me, if Hashem comes and speak to you and say, jump from the Empire State Building, don't worry, I would land you safely. Would you jump? No. He said, of course! Wow, Hashem tells me and I won't jump? I say, you want to bet you won't jump? Try to be honest. You stand in the mirror, you look at all the people, look like dots. Cars, these, sirens, Manhattan. And you're about to jump. Hashem said, don't worry, jump, I'll land you safely. You won't jump. What's the proof? In the roller coaster, I don't get on a roller coaster. But I know it's perfectly safe. Wow, 7 years, nobody fell from there. It's all locks, this, that, safety, checking. It's safe, it's scary, it's safe. But I'm afraid to get on it. So even in 100% in your logic, still, your body is not always cooperate. It's called, in psychology, it's called cognitive dissonance. What the brain understand, the heart not always comply. It takes much, much slower. Moshe knew the snake cannot bite him. Ah, Hashem, make this miracle, the snake go against me. In his logic, he knew it. But you saw that he got scared. And Vayanos mipanav. You know what Vayanos? Went right away back. Got very scared from him.
Maybe that's his reaction. It's a normal reaction.
He's a human being, isn't he? Normal reaction. Now, I would leave you with one last thing. You know, in Parashat Beshalach, Moshe screamed to Hashem. The Jews have to cross the ocean, the Dead Sea. And Moshe begin to scream, to pray to Hashem. And Hashem say to him, Mati tzak elai. What are you screaming to me now? What kind of question Hashem ask him? Moshe should have said to him, if I don't scream to you, who will I scream to my grandma? What do you mean, what do you scream to me? You educated us to pray in you, to believe in you, to have faith in you. Now we're going to die. The army of Pharaoh is behind us. Bad animals are all over. The ocean does not split. I begin to panic and scream to you. And you ask me, why you screaming to me? What did Hashem mean by that? Who understands this? Mati tzak elai. Why are you screaming to me?
When it's time to do,
The answer is, Hashem already told him before, Pharaoh would not listen to you. וחיזקתי את לב פרעו. I will make the heart of Pharaoh tighter, stubborn, stiff. ורדף אחריהם, and he will run, he will chase you. Hashem already told Moshe the plan. It's a part of the movie. So imagine the actor, see someone comes with a gun and he gets scared. What are you getting scared? You read the script 500 times. You know someone is going to come with a gun and he's going to miss you. You're red. Don't worry. The gun won't, you won't die. Still have a job for a few more episodes. Why are you nervous? You know the future. Hashem said to him, I'm going to make the heart of Pharaoh very stubborn, and he will chase you. Why? Because I want to bury them. I want to destroy them. The only way to destroy him and his army is to make them chase you, and then I'm going to have the final punch and bury them alive. So why Moshe is screaming? Moshe should have sat and smoked his cigar. And they say to him, Moshe, what are you doing? We're about to die. And Moshe would smile and say, we will see who's about to die. That's what it looks like. That's why Hashem said to him, why are you screaming to me? I already told you, it's a part of the plan. In that case, Yaakov Avinu, Hashem already promised him, I'm going to watch you. I will protect you. I'm going to do everything with you. And then Yaakov, after his dream, he said to Hashem, if you give me clothes to wear, food to eat, and this, and protect me on my way, everything you give me, I'll give you 10%. What is this? I already signed you a personal guarantee. You have an unlimited credit card. Now you tell me if you give me what to eat, I'm going to give you 10%. You have your unlimited credit card of Sheikh Farouk from Dubai. $1 billion to start. No limit. So why are you worried now if you have what to eat tomorrow? What's the answer? Chazal say, Pachad Yaakov Avinu Shema Gara Machet. Yeah, you promised me, I know, but since then I made sins. Maybe came the sins and spill all the water from the bucket. I have nothing left to drink. So if you will continue to give me, then I'll promise I make a neder, I give you 10%. Pachad Yaakov Shema Gara Machet. But reality, halacha is, everything good Hashem promised cannot be dismissed. Even you make all the sins, it's already signed in your file, it was wired already. By Hashem, when Hashem decided to give you on Rosh Hashanah this year $1 million profit, it was already wired. He didn't get the wire yet, but it was sent. There's no reverse. Penalty can be reversed. The fine was sent, but it didn't get to the right time, and you did repentance, it can be dismissed. You get it, you reap it. Because the penalty always comes with a warning. If, since we send you this, you paid the fine already, disregard this letter. That's what Hashem said. I'm sending you a big punishment on the mail. Pay this fine. But if you paid it, which means you pay, you repent, disregard the warning. But in a good thing, there's no, if you already got, return it. It's yours, you got it, it's yours. That's the difference. Now, one last question for today, and I'm sending you home with a very strong question that I doubt that if you're going to be able to find an answer by next Monday, but at least you have homework. Okay. What is it? It says that when Esav, he was a wicked person, Esav, the brother of Yaakov, and he made 5 sins, murder, avodah zarah, all kinds of sins. One of the sins he did, he went with a married woman, Baal Anahara Meorasa. There are 2 steps in Jewish marriage. Erusin, followed by Kiddushin. There's only one difference between Nahara Meorasa to Nahara Mekudeshet. Meorasa means he puts the ring on her finger, he gave her ketubah, 2 witnesses saw it, they make chupa, he broke the glass, everyone make kulululululu. People started to dance, oh, dishama, everything. They made sheva brachot. It was beautiful. But they didn't move in yet. Didn't move in, and God forbid, she cheated. They didn't move in yet. They didn't have relation yet. She deserved execution, and the one who made the sin with her also. But she wasn't 100% officially married. She was 99% married. Same thing, same punishment, even worse punishment. But it's called Nahara Meorasa. Eshet Ish means after they've been together for the first time and she's not a virgin anymore. That's called Eshet Ish. Mekudeshet, finished. That's the difference. Now in the old days, not like today, today between the marriage and until they move in, we're talking 2-3 hours.
Symbolically though.
2-3 hours.
Symbolically.
Wait, yeah. That's why the Ashkenazim, they don't want to wait 2-3 hours. Yeah. Why they want the bracha to go right away into action. So they send them into an isolation room. They put them together. It's enough that they can kiss each other and something, and that's enough already. It's already started the actual husband and wife thing. But one way or the other, everyone understands that if they were together or not together, after the ring, after Isaarat Mekudeshet Li, that's finished. She's a married woman. Everyone who goes with her, executed right away. How did Esav came to go with an engaged or a married woman when there was no marriage yet? When the laws of marriage started, when the Jews received the Torah in Mount Sinai. Way after Esav. Esav is at least 210 years before the Torah was given. Because remember, Yaakov went to Egypt. Yaakov and Esav was in the same time. And the Jews were slaves in Egypt for 210 years. But Yaakov went to Egypt way before they became slaves. So we're talking at least 300 years here, more or less. 300 years! 300 years before the laws of marriage started, the Gemara say, Esav ba'al ha'na'ara me'orasa. Rambam say, before the Torah was given to us, a person met a girl on the street and said, you like me? You like my mustache? She said, yes. You like my gel? Yes. You like my earring? Yes. You like my suit? Yes. You like my car? Yes. Let's move in together. Okay, no problem. What would you give me? Here, a bottle of Coca-Cola. Fine, good enough. That's it. They move in, fine. They leave, they don't need marriage. After the Torah was given, that's it. It has to be the whole ceremony, only for Jews. The Goyim stayed the way they were before Matan Torah. But Jews now have limitations. Esav, first of all, it was a Goy. It wasn't a Jew yet, officially. It was never circumcised. There was no way to circumcise him. His father saw his red. He said, let's wait a week. After a week, he was red. He waited. He said, let's wait a year. In the end, he was never circumcised. So one way or the other, even if it was circumcised, it was before Judaism officially started. So how ibal na'ara me'orasa? That's the question for next week, for next Monday.
How was the what?
You come up with the answer. Sami, if you did not get the question, tomorrow this will be on divineinformation.com. Go to the last minute. Listen to the question again.
You see, Yaakov married two sisters, but before the Torah, he's allowed to do it.
That was before Matan Torah.
Right.
There's an answer for it. But over here, there was no concept of being married.
Oh, okay.
If there's no concept of being married, how do you make a violation against a law that doesn't exist? Baruch Adonai l'olam, amen ve'amen.